layer. Now, the further germination will take place when they are landed on the female reproductive structure. But before that, you should understand a female reproductive structure, which is known as a gynoecium. Now, a gynoecium, you know that it is located centrally in the flower. A unit, it is known as a pistil. A typical pistil has a stigma, a style, and the ovary, which is the basal portion. Now, the ovary is actually the fertile portion. The style is for the pollen tube growth, and the stigma is for the, it is the seat of the pollen grains. Now, in this figure, you can see that when we take the transverse section of ovary, we can clearly see two wall layers. This one is the inner wall of the ovary, and the outer one, it is the outer wall of the ovary. Now, from the inner wall, we can also see some bulging tissue which is developing. This bulging tissue, it is known as a placenta, and on this placenta, the whole ovule is developing. So, ovule, it is developing on placenta, and in different plants, the number of ovules may vary. There may be only one ovule per ovary, there may be large number of ovules per ovary, and their arrangements are also different. But a very, very young ovule has a stalk, which is known as the funiculus. This you can see a stalk by means of which it stands on the placenta, and then the central body. This is the main body of the ovule, which is known as a nucellus. The nucellus is completely surrounded by two layers. These layers, they are known as integuments. There is two integument, the outer integument and the inner integument. These two integuments completely surrounds the nucellus, except at this region. This region, you can see that they form a very, very small opening, which is known as a micropyle. It is also known as a micropylar region. It is known as a pore because through this pore, when the pollen tube comes inside the ovary, then it will get directed towards the micropyle and takes its entry into the ovule. The end, which is just opposite to the micropyle, this region, it is known as the chalazal region. So friends, please remember, a young ovule has different structures. They have different parts of funiculus, which is a stalk. There are two protective layers, which are known as outer and inner integument respectively. There is one main body, which is known as a nucellus. The wall of the nucellus represents the megasporangium. And then inside the nucellus, there is only one single megaspore mother cell, which is diploid in nature. Now, there are large number of plants which show variation in the number of integuments. For example, if you see in this figure, there are two integuments, the outer and inner, which is the most commonest condition. You can see this type of ovule in most of the monocots and also members of family Polypetali, where the nucellus, it is always surrounded by two integuments. If such condition is there, then this is known as a bitegmic ovule. But we have family Acanthaceae. The members of family Acanthaceae, you can see that the nucellus which is there, it is surrounded by only one integument. Such condition, it is known as a unitegmic ovule. And there is another family which is known as Olecaceae. For example, Olex imbricata is a plant where the body of the nucellus, see this figure, the body of the nucellus, it is directly attached to the funiculus. There are no integuments, and such ovule, it is known as ategmic ovule. So friends, usually in flowering plants, with respect to the number of integuments, we have three types, the bitegmic, which is the most commonest one, the unitegmic and ategmic ovules. Now, as I have told you that bitegmic condition is the most commonest one, where both the integuments are involved in the formation of micropyle. You can see that this is the micropylar region. And these integuments, they are placed at different levels. For example, you can see here that the outer integument is overgrowing the inner one. If such condition is there, when the pollen tube enters from here and when it is directed towards the micropylar region, then a zigzag pathway it has to follow. But look at this second figure. In this, the outer and the inner integument, they are placed at the same level. They are almost at the same level. So when a pollen tube enters from the style and directed towards the micropylar region, then the pollen tube has straight pathway to follow. So both the conditions are possible in flowering plants. Now, we have seen the detailed structure of the integument. Simultaneously, you also have to study the nucellus types in different types of flowering plants. Now, as I have told you, nucellus is the main body of the ovule. It is the site where the future megaspore mother cell is going to develop. Now, let us see how this future megaspore mother cell is developing. Look at this figure. There is a nucellus. A very young nucellus has only a single layer, which is known as a nucellar epidermis. And of course, there are cells here, which is filling up the cavity of the nucellus, which is known as a nucellar tissue. Now, in some flowering plant, in the young nucellus, a single cell, a fertile cell, is developing just below the epidermal region. Just see in the figure, this is the nucellar epidermis, an archisporial cell is developing in the hypodermal region. Now, this archisporial cell, it is a fertile cell, and in these plants, this archisporial cell, which is located in the hypodermal region, it is directly function as megaspore mother cell without undergoing any type of division. So, such type of nucellus where the archisporial cell or megaspore mother cell is hypodermal, then such type of nucellus, it is known as teninucellar type of nucellus. So, this is also found in some of the flowering plants. Now, we have other category of plant where the archisporial cell is developing just like this, just like the first one, just like the previous one. It is in the hypodermal region, but then it undergoes a transverse division. Now, you can see in this figure, this archisporial cell, it is undergoing division. So, two cells are formed. The outer one is the parietal cell. The inner one is the sporogenous cell. Now, this parietal cell, it will undergo rapid anticlinal and periclinal division. Students, do you know what is anticlinal and periclinal division? Anticlinal meaning this way, and periclinal meaning this way, on the sides, on both the sides, as a result of which the sporogenous cell or the archisporial cell which is formed, it is pushed at the center of the nucellus. Just see this figure. And the tissue around this sporogenous cell becomes multicellular. Whereas over here, it was only unicellular, only one flat plate of tissue. Here, it becomes multicellular. And moreover, the sporogenous cell, which is now functioning as future megaspore mother cell, it is getting embedded within the nucellus. So, such type of nucellus, it is known as crassinucellate type of nucellus. So, friends, regarding nucellus type, again, we have two types, the teninucellate and the crassinucellate, of which the crassinucellate is the most commonest one. Now, let us see what happens further. In some flowering plants, or you can say many flowering plants, you can see some extra outgrowth. That extra outgrowth, they comes out as swelling, and they comes out either from the funiculus, which is the stalk of the ovule, or they are coming out from the integuments, or even they are coming out from the placenta. Now, as we know that ovules are situated deep down into the ovary, and in most of the cases the ovule is curved, so that is why it has to direct the pollen tube towards the micropylar region. So friends, remember that these structures which are coming out as outgrowths, they are known as obturators. They are helping in directing the pollen tube towards the micropylar region to affect pollination as well as fertilization. So obturators are also seen in large number of plants which are helping the pollen tube. They are creating stimulus for the entry of pollen tube directly into the micropylar region. Now usually in unitegmic ovule, friends, you now know that regarding the number of integument, we have three types: bitegmic, unitegmic and ategmic. Mostly in unitegmic ovule, you know that the nucellus is surrounded by only one integument. And here also, as we have seen earlier, the archisporial cell is developing in the hypodermal region. But after that, the whole nucellus, which you can see in this slide, they are undergoing rapid degeneration. But then the archisporial cell has to develop into future megaspore mother cell. It has to carry out further process, and for that nutritive substances are required. So in that case, the whole integument, the one integument which is surrounding the nucellus, it becomes septate like this, just see in this figure. And then they store large amount of food material, and their cell as well, they are secretory. They store food material as well as they secrete the food material, and they are supplying or transporting this nutritive substances to the developing archisporial cell so that it can undergo further process. This type of integument where the cells becomes storage organ or they are secretory, it is known as endothelium. Endothelium usually observed in unitegmic ovules only. Bitegmic ovules generally we have not observed endothelium. Now in different flowering plants, the ovule types are also different. For example, embryologists, they have classified ovules on the basis of the position of this micropylar region and this funiculus. You know that micropyle is created by two integuments. It is a small pore for the entry of pollen tube, and funiculus is the stalk of the ovule. So in some plants, the ovule becomes straight so that the micropylar region and the funiculus, they lie like this in a straight line. Such type of ovule is known as orthotropous ovule. The second type, which is this one, it is known as anatropous ovule, which is found among 90% angiospermic plant, where the micropyle, the ovule gets curved like this. Just see in this figure, the ovule is getting curved and the micropyle lies very close to the funiculus. Such type of ovule where the micropyle is very near to the funiculus and the body of the ovule is getting curved without affecting the shape of the nucellus. You can just see that the nucellus remains as it is. It does not change the shape of the nucellus. Such type of curved ovule, it is known as anatropous ovule. The third type is hemianatropous ovule, where you can see that the micropyle is placed at right angle to the funiculus, so that the micropyle and funiculus are quite far away from one another. And that is why this type of ovule, it is known as hemitropous or hemianatropous ovule. The fourth type, again, it is curved like anatropous ovule, but the curvature is little less. Just see this. In figure B, the ovule has curved nature, micropyle and funiculus very close. But in this, ovule is getting curved, but the micropyle is somewhat distantly placed. That is why this micropyle and this funiculus has some gap between them. Such type of ovule, it is known as compylotropous ovule. Here also, the curvature of the ovule doesn't affect the shape of the nucellus. And finally, we have last type of ovule, that is known as amphitropous ovule. In this type, it is very similar to this anatropous ovule. The ovule gets curved, the micropyle is very near to the funiculus, but the curvature of the ovule also affects the shape of the nucellus. In this figure, you can see that the nucellus becomes horseshoe shaped. So, such type of ovule is known as amphitropous ovules. Friends, there are 5 different types of ovules observed among different flowering plants. The most commonest one is the anatropous ovule, and therefore the further discussion that we are carrying out will be only for anatropous ovule and not for other ovules. Under electron microscope, if we take section of the ovule, we can see that the ovule has a curved nature, and this is the nucellar tissue, and the one which is located here, it is now known as megaspore mother cell. This megaspore mother cell is diploid in nature. Friends, do you remember microsporogenesis? In the microsporogenesis, in the male organ, in the pollen chamber, initially there were pollen mother cell or microspore mother cell, and then they undergo process which is known as microsporogenesis. In the same way, when the ovule, when the nucellus develops one megaspore mother cell, it will also undergo meiosis. Just see in this slide. The first division of megaspore mother nucleus is a meiotic division, as a result of which 2 cells are formed. This one, these 2 daughter cells, they undergo further division, and then they form 4 haploid spores, which are also known as haploid megaspores or 4 haploid megaspores. So, in a quite mature ovule, friends, remember that the ovule has a stalk, it is known as a funiculus, it is again having 2 protective layers, those are integuments, it is having a micropylar region, a chalazal region. In the nucellus, now there is a formation of 4 megaspores that are haploid. Now, as we have seen that when the pollens are formed after microsporogenesis, then we can see different type of arrangement of those microspores. In the similar manner,